So let's see. So it's wonderful to see you all here. It's always a pleasure to have this every year and almost every 6 months. And it's a special pleasure to introduce Haejin Yoon. So I've known Haejin probably for about a year, I think, if I'm remembering correctly, maybe just slightly over a year. And I've known her through one of the usual exercises that we do at SFI. Haejin was running a working group, a discussion group on sort of a set of complicated things that continue to be a subject of endless fascination, namely information theory and language and other ways to try to quantify structures in language and try to understand what universals there may be and how, in some sense, it also operates computationally, at least in the very abstract sense of information theory. So I came to appreciate, so Haejin had the difficult job of actually suggesting new ideas and perhaps things that we would read and discuss. And many of you have been part of this, but it's actually one of the hardest exercises for any scientist at any level, and particularly for a young scientist. And so I came to appreciate, because of just the sheer variety of points of view and because we just create chaos out of order quite often before anything much later can emerge. And so Haejin's, I came to admire Haejin in the sense that she was able to really kept many elements of the faculty focused and extract insight and order out of much of the chaos that we created. And that must be a sure sign of somebody that belongs at SFI. So so from that, a few months later, when we had an opportunity to hire a postdoc to work with us on cities and social systems, I thought that Haejin would just be the perfect person, and it has been so. So today she'll be telling you a little bit about work that's very new, that she started as she came to SFI. So she just graduated from her PhD from the Korean Advanced Institute of Science and Technology. That's the premier place in Korea for complex systems, and many interesting things have come through there and from people associated with it. And so Haejin had started some very interesting work about how to quantify density in social systems. And this was related to both transportation and also properties of human societies and of cities. This may be obvious to you, but it's actually a very hard problem in social systems, and particularly social societies like nations and cities, to appreciate that most of what we do is actually, most of what we do that's interesting is local. We rely on social interactions, and usually close social interactions, to create all the magic that human societies do, and that has come to transcend what biology can do. So you saw this morning that much of what we do, of course, at SFI is to try to get to what those interactions are, how they're structured, what they produce. And one way is to come from the bottom up, but another way, perhaps the way where we see already what their value is to come from the top down. And so we've come to understand that at the level of markets, at the level of cities, social interactions do produce a lot of magic in terms of creativity, in terms of economic value. But in order to really understand how they do that and what the essence of those interactions is, you have to now start zooming in. And Haejin has been working on this idea of creating measures of density that cross-bridge the scales from large social systems to more and more detailed ones, and to get to the soul of what these interactions are. So she'll be telling you about that today. She calls, in the context of cities, this issue, she calls it citier, and this basically is a way of invoking a process rather than a noun. It's the idea that as you change the size of the city, as you have more people interacting, you have that the properties of the system as a whole change, and by trying to measure how this density is approximating ways of measuring social interactions, you are able to perhaps start to disentangle how is it that the large-scale structure of human interactions create all this magic. You will also appreciate from her talk that it is a difficult thing to do. This is a subject of many decades in economics that's been very difficult to disentangle the effects of density from other effects that are also present in cities. But I think the other thing that you'll see is that, and that I came to admire as I first met Haejin, is that she has a very nice knack for showing you complicated data and very complex things in visually very beautiful ways. So without further ado, Haejin, please.
Okay, thank you, Luis. Good morning, I'm Haejin Yoon. Today, as introduced, I'm going to talk about a very exciting topic, cities with three major keywords. Three major keywords: bigger, denser, greener. And the city is some invented word intentionally used to show what's the idea of our work and framework. And denser here, a bigger is in terms of a population, denser in terms of a density, greener in terms of CO2. You get through our main goal. Half of my goal is to walk you through from the top to the greener, bigger to the greener, and our framework, general idea of our framework. And toward the end, we'll have some ongoing interesting questions and research and so on. But this is like ongoing work. You'll see a lot of things should be done in the end, in the future. So why we care about city? We live in the cities. Most people live in the city, especially the United States. I think 82% of people live in this small area, which is called urban cities. And also, the number of people living in the city will increase more and faster, especially in developed countries. So UN expect 80% of the people will live, all human beings will live in the city in the end. So cities are and will be our main concern. At the same time, so main concern of our sustainability. So interestingly, cities create a lot of problems and have a solution, and we'll get to the part when we talk about the greener part. And besides all the practical issues here, cities are interesting by itself, just connected, interconnected, complicated, and kind of self-organizing kind of metaphor, its favors and of that and all. So I will start some nice visualization of the cities to appetite you. So this is New York. So I will go through some of the cities in the United States. So on the left-hand side, you'll get the kind of caricature of the city, and on the right-hand side, you'll have the pictures of the city, typical pictures of the city. So you see the Liberty of the Statue of the Liberty, and the Hollywood sign in the LA, and San Francisco, Chicago, and all the cities. If you see the picture on the left, you recognize, oh, that's the Chicago, and that's the LA. But on the right hand side, it's kind of easy, not easy to what the city is, and that's the point I'm going to make. So we are focusing on the pictures on the right. And I made this kind of, for this talk, I made a kind of art. It's a collage of all the pictures on the right-hand side, and which reflect the idea that they look kind of alike in some sense. I mean, at least to me, it's very similar to each other. So that's the question we want to make. Can we make them in some kind of abstract way so that we can do some science-based theory? So I put down several properties which came up in my mind with the pictures and all the concept of cities. And that's the kind of main playground I'll play with throughout this talk. So cities, bigger size in terms of population, and more interaction when you think about city, richer, more creative, smarter, faster moving, and more crime, more disease, and density, and crowdedness, and all. Those kind of things are there. My background is physical physics, so what we do with this is just first thing we want to do when you have a lot of variable is to see what's the interplay, interplay with each other, and in what functional form. That's the question we, once you have those kind of things. As simple, and the functional form should be simple, as simple possible. And finally, what are the smallest set of variables that can explain, other things? What's the essential variables in a more systematic and macroscopic way, if it's possible? And toward the end, And also if we can do that, we also want to see what's the microscopic dynamics behind this macroscopic features. So in this spirit, we first start from the size. By size, we mean population of a given city. So we consider the population as a metric of city size and see how other properties follow in what functional form. So that's the like kind of nowadays kind of famous overscaling. On the x-axis, you have a population. On the y-axis, you have a lot of properties you've seen from the conceptual space. And then do the plot and see how it looks like. And so I'd like to point out to appreciate what this picture means. One, they all follow some systematic trend. It's not like a zigzagging and some strange one, but it's more like a systematically increase. Second, they all collapse in the same figure. That's quite interesting. And third, they all follow we can express this function as a simple power law, n to the beta, and the beta is greater than one. What does this all things mean? Is that as city grows, or the bigger city, richer, more creative, more crime, and more smarter people, and moving faster in the same way, in the same behavior. That's the kind of striking things one can be. I mean, now you can surprise. So let's go back to our conceptual space, all the variable there. So we start from this as an x-axis. And then we just move across out things. Okay, we've done these and that. Of course, this one might get offended, and this doesn't mean we explain everything. It's just there are certain assumptions, and I would like to say, there are some rooms for cities can be unique. So, but in this framework, it's just so we cross out of there and. I have two things left over. So we go from the density, and whether, and then make a question, whether it's bigger, denser. And yes, actually bigger is denser. So people get together and getting a bigger bigger city as denser. But you see a lot of some leftover, and it's a kind of, so I say yes, but there are some variations or variants not explained by size. So there are things explained, but not explained by size. So as a first approximation, you just take out all the theoretical values from the density and get some leftover and see whether this leftover can play an independent role, like size of the city. So we can do the same thing with what we did with the size of the city, the population. So we plot the x-axis on the density on the x-axis, a kind of leftover density, unexplained by the size, and the leftover of the GMP. GMP is the GDP of city. And see, it's denser doesn't mean richer. So what does that mean? So the size explains everything. So there is nothing left over for density to play an independent role. So density is some kind of subordinate of the size. I will come to that point later. So I can just, as a playground of scientists, I just put this kind of question mark with a bigger size. So density is a bigger, but it's just, some kind of curious way. And then I go to the more interaction. So when you think about cities, why cities are good? It has a more interaction, and some notion of more interaction. So how we measure the interaction? Here are some basic idea that interaction occurs in a local basis, local area basis. So we put the geographical proximity as a basis of the interaction. That becomes a interaction is proportional to the density times kind of local area. But so you find the density. Oh, can density do something here? Maybe not. And we also know density has some kind of problem because density is number of people divided by the arbitrarily defined area, boundary area. So area can be very, you know, arbitrary, and density might suffer from that arbitrariness. So we want to find out some kind of effective density. What does that mean? I'll just, you know, see with this picture, I will explain. So this is a night view of the worldwide global night view. And here, I just pick up the two, it's not random, but two cities. Two countries to see, you know, more dramatic result. And one Japan, one Egypt. And they are actually ranked in their density ranked on the 38 and 124. That means Japan is denser than Egypt. But thing is, you know, when you think of, when you heard of people from Egypt or, you know, who traveled in Egypt, say Egypt is very, very crowded place. And what happened? What's wrong? So if you see the, you know, inside of the population distribution, you'll see that Japan is kind of spread over on the contrary of the Egypt, where people live in a very small Nile area, and there are lots of empty place. And when you consider interaction or density, you don't really want to count the middle of nowhere, where, I mean, you don't meet people in a desert or something. So we want to take out all of these kind of things in a more systematic way. So I will talk about this in a kind of schematic figure. So suppose we have a two extreme case. This may be, I mean, this is one very localized, and the other, like Egypt, and the other is a kind of spread out, and, you know, to make a calculation easier, uniform distribution. Remember, and then I put the people, the same number of people, eight, and the same area. So in the end, you'll get the same nominal density. But if one wants to ask, and how many people do you meet in a day? That kind of notion of interaction. Then, assume that the interaction occur in a local basis, which is denoted as a yellow dot dash area, a sphere. And then ask, you know, kind of thought experiment. Ask around, how many people do you meet? And in people might say, you know, this remote one, say one, and the people flock together, say three, four, and all. And the other case will say one, you know, I just picked up the arbitrary number, 1.2. But you'll get the idea. And in the end, this has more interaction than that. Or this has more effective density, effectively denser than that, this uniform case, even if the density is the same. So this is the idea we want to capture, and that's actually something similar to what we, what people in the solid physics doing with the localization of the distribution and all. And this also related to the idea of the information of the distribution, spatial distribution, and correlation dimension of the distribution and all. But the basic idea is just to count the people surrounding one in a local basis. So if I apply this method to the cities, what happens? So this is the rank of the density of the cities. And you see New York, San Juan, and Chicago all the way down to the Las Vegas. And if I apply this density, then the rank change, unfortunately, Dallas goes, I mean, it's not unfortunately, it's better to be, no, less dense city. So Dallas goes down, and some prominent cities goes up. And I'm not going to the detail of this result because we want to find out a more interesting question, whether this effective density going to play an independent role in other variables. what density has failed. So I plot the same thing. I plot the residual density, residual of effective density that I calculated, and GMP, GDP of the cities. And we find some kind of correlation. I mean, it's not satisfying, as I said, but it's capturing something. I don't know. I mean, we are working on that. So this picture shows once you control the size of a city, then the denser city is kind of poorer, or the other way around. No, less denser is better. And this is quite surprising because the one before you see no correlation. If once you take out all the size effect, you have no effect of the density. But here you got something going on there in terms of richness. But we are working on that. So this is kind of new in research. So we move on to the more interesting question on the city. Greener part. So in the first slide, I mentioned that cities create many problems but find out their solution as well. So this is applied to this part too. Cities are accused of environmental degradation and immense ecological burden, but we also know cities can solve the problem in a way of environmentally efficient by being denser or something. So we want to investigate this in more data-driven way. So we among all the issues, we look at the CO2 emissions of the cities. CO2 as a main culprit of the global warming, as you know, one of the hottest topic today. And indeed, if you see this, the first picture, this is a time series of the CO2 emission, or you can say the ecological footprint, combining all the something bad we are doing, and that's the total amount by in time, and that one you take out CO2 emission of the whole total, and green dash. Is the sustain the capability of the Earth. So once you take out all the CO2, which is the really large amount and growing very fast, you will get the like kind of sustainable kind of notion. And this picture is the same, but at a certain time, 2006, how countries are doing per each. And you'll see United States are on best. and the shade area are the carbon emission. And that's the very large. And once you take out, the green again is just a sustainable amount that we can get down to the here. So this shows, I mean, it's not really showing something, but more like CO2 is quite important. Even if a CO2 emission is one of the hottest topics nowadays, the studies are mainly done by individual tracking down or longitudinal way. But only recently we have three data available across the cities. So we are gonna use this Brookings, Vulcan, Glazer, and Kahn, and they are all independently collected. And CO2 emission is divided by the four major sectors. Among them, so transportation, residential, industrial, commercial. Among them, two of them are going to be used in our data set, which because those are only thing available in the data set. So, but it's noteworthy that two of sectors, the way of saving of two of sectors are different from the others, like commercial, industrial. So it's more related to our lifestyle. So it's the same, the framework. We ask the question whether bigger means greener. So we put the y-axis the same population and x-axis the two sectors and total of the CO2 emissions. and do the plot, and yes, CO2, in terms of CO2, bigger city is greener. If you see the beta is beta here, it's a great smaller than one, which is actually different from what we have seen in the previous picture that every exponent is 1.15, and here we have a different exponent. And the implication beta is smaller than one is per capita basis, CO2, we are producing less CO2 than, or the bigger city produces less CO2 than the smaller. Now we can ask the same, the same question we did previously. Is density essential variable playing a role in this picture, CO2 emission? So we take out here the same. So we take out the, this is like the size, density, and take out the size part of the density, and we plot the x-axis here and y-axis is the variable of there. And surprisingly, I think it's surprising that residential sector does not depend on the density, but transportation sector is yes. So you see the trend. There is no trend for the residential sector, but there is a trend for the transportation sector. So notion is that once you take out the size dependence of the density, the size dependence of the CO2 emission, then there is nothing left in the residential sector. But there are some reduction in the transportation sector. And we can now ask the question the other way around. Can we find out the bigger is denser when you take out all the density part in the data? So I'll do the same thing with a different order of the procedure. So they are changed and they are changed. And you see there is no dependence on the transportation, no dependence of the size in the transportation sector, saving in the house is actually saved by living in a large city. So this is the recap. It turns out that the denser means greener, yes, when you're concerned with the emissions from your moving. But there is no advantage of living in a bigger city in terms of moving. But it can go the other way around if you go to the residential sector. So, this is the last slide of the greener part. But I will close this talk with a simple exercise to show how to play with the variables, like what we did, under our framework. So if someone wants to know how CO2 emission is related to the GMP, then with the relationship we find, we can find out the relationship. So CO2, we know in the previous section, we know CO2 goes to the n to the 1.9, and GMP goes to the n to the 1.2, around 2. We can have the idea that CO2 should go to GMP to the 0.75. And the data shows support our idea that it goes with the 0.76. So this is like, some might have entertained yourself that this number is kind of, if you know the Clifford's law, then metabolic rate goes with the size of the size of the organism, 0.75, and we find that the kind of metabolism and size, I don't know yet, but it's this quite interesting number, so I just plotted it, see that. And yeah, so notion is that if you are richer, then you produce the CO2 less than per unit of your production. So that's the idea of this picture and how you use our method to find out what you're interested in. So here is the last slide, the summary. It's more like a big picture. We are pursuing that the question of what are the fundamentals that determine all other macroscopic variables we've seen, and there are lots of more coming up, and their relationship in terms of mathematical formula and what's the functional form and all. And ambitiously, this is kind of ambitious part, I just said. So what are the underlying microscopic model that explain all the macroscopic behavior we've observed? So here are our ambitious people. The bigger part is done by Luis and Jeffrey, and Dancer. I worked with the people I worked with in when I was a graduate. And the greener part, I'm just starting working with Luis and Jeffrey. And they helped me out in this talk a lot. And thank you. Question?
Interesting questions, but it also seems to me that trying to answer them merely by looking at data and correlating it is a very, very dull tool. I think that many economists have looked at problems of the role of transportation in the cost of things, and in things where transportation becomes a big cost, then there's a big advantage to being local, and for things where transportation is a small cost, there's no advantage to being local. And I think that this is why you get these things more or less saying things have equilibrated, except in the transportation sector, across the sizes of cities. If you think about it in practical terms, if you really believed that the 0.1 exponent that you got was really important for something, then it would say, well, we might get in a factor of two effect when the cities are 32 times bigger than they are now. And I think by the time cities are 32 times bigger as they are now, we're going to have a lot of other practical problems. And the scaling relation certainly wouldn't hold at that point.
Yes, I admit this is, one part of this project is about the data-driven theory. But I might have mentioned or not, statistical physics, before the statistical physics, we observe everything macroscopically and the volume of gas and pressure and all, it's just measured and observe what the relationships are. That's the first thing, and macroscopically. Step forward, what's the microscopic behavior, you find entropy and all explained all the macroscopic behavior. That's the one part. The other part is, yes, the urban economists doing the similar thing, but in a different way, and we believe both of the approach are valuable to answer the question of what we are looking for. One example is urban economists believe the density is the most important things in the urban dynamics, but we find density might not be relevant in some sense, and some sense, yes. So we can we can find out in a finer scale more sophisticated definition or the role of one variable the other. So it's kind of a little bit different approach, and it gives a different advantage.
Yeah, one of the countervailing trends is, as people become more concentrated in cities, for example, they become more vulnerable to exogenous and endogenous shocks. So, for example, I think it's been estimated that between a third to a half of the world's populations will live in major cities within 50 years along seismically active zones. So it makes you vulnerable in today's economy with supply chain disruptions like we've seen in Japan to global impacts and negative impacts from major disasters hitting cities. These things are sudden, they are difficult to forecast and predict, although we're making progress on that. And you know, it's sort of a cautionary note. The last thing I'd like to say is I like the fact that you're using William Clark up there as a statue. He had a major impact on the island of Hokkaido back in the late 1800s, so that's very encouraging.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. So it's, yeah, so I assume that's more comment than the question, yeah.
Giving them the big, because in some sense what you did, because it's correlational, not causal, you subtracted out that portion of the data where density and size are very well correlated. But mechanistically speaking, getting to this question, it's much more likely that density is the driving force than size. And so you didn't really make that as clear as possible, because it was really that little bit of residual variation that you were trying to account with effective density. But if you went back and used your effective density value to predict all of those features that you ruled out, you might get a much better fit than you did with pure size.
The question, in other words, is what is the right effect? What's the right,
exactly.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
You mentioned at the end that you were interested in what you were calling microscopic theories, which would generate the macroscopic relationships that you showed us. Can you give me, I realize this is work yet to be done, but could you give me an example of what a microscopic theory might look like? What are the variables? What form does the theory take?
Okay. So if I knew it, I could have. But okay. But I'll do the yes. One. Instead of answering to your question directly, but I'll just say the what statistical mechanics related to the thermodynamics. In the thermodynamics, you know, if you compress with a power or what is this, like a force, then you can compress and volume decrease and pressure increase. So that's the macroscopic features. But if you go inside of that and see it with a microscope and see how the particles are moving around and see the temperature, what the temperature is, the statistical physics says energy, so temperature, which is macroscopic behavior, is a number of configuration or ensemble states at a given energy how the number of microscopic configuration changes over the energy change. So does that give you some kind of answer?
Well, by analogy, I was interested in what the variables might be.
Okay, right.